Good morning. Before we begin our service, memorial service, I'd just like to remind you to turn off your cell phone or put it on silent mode or airplane mode so as not to be disruptive during the service. Couple of acknowledgement that there are people joining online, but we will not be able to acknowledge you during the service. But our technical support team will mark down your presence if you're joining online, and we'll give that list to the family at the end of the service so that your presence is acknowledged. It will be acknowledged, but just not during the service. Also want to acknowledge that the land on which we gather this morning is the traditional unceded territory of the Algonquin Anishinaabe people.
The intent of the enactments to secure the Protestant succession to the throne, uphold and maintain the said enactments to the best of my powers according to law.
The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. God's mercies never come to an end.
200 people going to protest the coronation, and they chanted, "Not my king," and booed St. Charles's golden carriage rolled past. But when we talk to people here, they tell us they believe the monarchy is outdated and that it's a symbol of entrenched privilege and colonialism. They also say it's an expense during when the UK is experiencing a serious cost of living crisis.
Patrick Rebel reporting from London. The environmental activism group Just Stop Oil says around 20 of its supporters were arrested for protesting during the coronation celebration. Meantime, back home, begin.
To remember the ways his life touched ours, then to entrust him into the keeping of God. We have also come to share the sorrow of those who mourn, to be with Jan, Stephen, Ruth Ann, and their families, and to offer them our love and support. And we are here to bear witness to our hope in Jesus Christ, who said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die." Let us pray. O gracious God, our Heavenly Father, in your mercy you sent Jesus Christ to be for us the way, the truth, and the life. He lived our life and he died our death. He rose again to give us new life and hope. He proclaimed to us that he is the resurrection and the life. And whoever believes in Christ, though they may die, shall yet live.
Group of people who have focused on outreach in their programming. So they were a natural fit for senior concert because they've done a lot of work with children, they've done a lot of work with older adults.
First online is going on here. Offer virtual concerts, and the feedback has been overwhelming.
The senior concerts were a great way for me to know other people, participants of the Alzheimer's Society. They're online too, and comment. It's just great. Like, it's something to look forward to.
Wendy Lau's 95-year-old mother Nancy has lost him, and before recently suffering a stroke, get a few of
him. As we care for ourselves, to pardon and to accept pardon, we remember good intentions that were not put into actions, harsh words that were hurtful, and selfish purposes that caused pain, or persistent pride that would not yield. We acknowledge our fear in the face of death and our failure to accept the hope you offer us in Christ. Hear us, O Lord, as in this silence we make our confession to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Friends and sisters and brothers in Christ, on the day of resurrection, our Lord declared peace to those who had been shattered by his death. So to all who turn to God, trusting in Christ as Lord and Savior and as King of heaven, the same risen Christ says to you, in the midst of our sorrow, peace be with you. Amen. Let us stand and sing hymn 407, Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven.
Bob Fourney was born into a three-generation Christian family on a farm. Each person was expected for the supper meal, no excuses. As head of the household, John first invited the Holy Spirit to join them. He then read scripture, and everyone was to ask questions and offer answers. Later, everyone was to have a discussion about what they had learned or not. And everyone was also to practice learning that there was an unseen guest at the table. Bob was very competitive and goal-orientated when he was young, right from birth, I think. Bob learned about many ideas of his family members' feelings, how to live with them, avoid them, or encourage them. He became very active in church activities. During his teen years, Bob was very aware his Lord was literally guiding him into ministry in a church pulpit. An eye doctor gave him glasses to help his weak eyesight. The doctor said Bob's eyes might greatly improve at age 40. They did. Bob attended the University of McGill in Montreal 1 year and failed. He started seminary studies the next year at Presbyterian College. Feeling very convicted, he planned to move to Toronto Seminary with no job prospects, no definite place to live, and full of confidence that his faith in his living Lord would give him what he needed. The Lord did. The years growing up at home convinced Bob his parents' marriage was solid. Bob married before moving to Toronto. He thought his marriage should mirror that of his parents. Bob's deepest desire was to be a father. Bob wanted to have a large family. Our son arrived in 1976, then our daughter in 1971, and then our daughter in 1976. The Holy Spirit told Bob with his improved eyesight to try and earn a doctorate. Our children were in their teens when Bob suffered a massive heart attack. And he existed between life and death for some time. Our son Stephen stepped up to keep his family members on schedule and not forgetting to do things on time and such. And he was only in his teens at that point. So I'm very grateful that his maturity showed at that time. And then we talk about Bob wanting a large family. Over the years, it came to him, and it was from group homes, from byways, from prison, from runaways, and so on. So he can't complain he didn't have a large family. He just didn't realize all the responsibility God was going to give him. And then another deep-seated dream of Bob's, unknown to any of us for years, was to have a cottage. And we achieved that. As our grandchildren came into the family, Papa was so, so happy that he could share time with them at the cottage, away from much else. Now, over many decades in between, Bob had a lot of challenges in many directions. God always met them, but not always the way Bob wanted to see it. And he became annoyed with God by times. That's not what you're supposed to do. And God kept repeating, putting him in similar situations until he learned that he should pay attention to what he was being told. And then later on, he had a lot of illness and a lot of pain, and people who were Christian friends, prayed for him, supported him, went the second and third mile to look after him, and that was all God's doing. I was too busy with the family. Anyway, to end this, Bob at the end of his life was in a lot of pain, immense pain, and he had a major prayer on his lips. Could he find something to do with his grandchildren? Even though he was weak, his mind was going, and he was shaky. And God answered him in the word baking. And when Bob got into baking, he became quite good at it. And he wanted to be always giving glory to the Lord. So on everything he baked, he wrote a Christian cross as his witness to the Lord he served. March 23rd, God took him home, and all of us were with him, and all of us mourned him in our own way. On the other hand, today, which is a memorial for him, we're not thinking of Bob with his earthly body. We know he's in heaven in his eternal body, and he's with the Lord that he tried all his life to serve, and to the best of his ability, I must say, wasn't perfect. And we greet the thought with joy that he is in light and with the Lord's love, and he's doing what he wanted to do all his life and with his life, and that is to always praise the Lord.
Hello, everyone. So as you know, I am Leia. I'm one of the older grandkids. I wanted to speak today to tell you all who we're here to celebrate. We're here to celebrate a friend, a minister, a husband, a father, and a grandfather. This memorial is to celebrate him and who he was in all aspects of his life. So I wanted to explain some of the things that made him who he was. To start, I always called him Papa. All of us grandkids did. From what he told me, he wanted the fun alternative to grandfather. He told me once that a grandfather was an old man with a thick white beard, which he wasn't. He said he was neither old nor did he have a white beard, so that crossed that off the list. So we called him Papa. Papa always made us feel special. When he and my grandmother would babysit, my brother and I, he would always make pancakes and sausages for dinner, and he always gave us orange juice in the morning. He would help us with our prayers and made sure we included everyone, and never shied away from a gentle teasing. He taught us that even as we got older, we didn't have to be afraid to be silly. He was a baker. He was always on the hunt for recipes, and our time together was spent largely in the kitchen. Baking was one of his ways of showing love. Pies were one of his favorites, so much so that when he was a baby, his first word was pie. Apple pies were how we bonded. We'd laugh at the absurdity of the mountains of apples or the disastrous amount of cinnamon. I'd play Frank Sinatra or Buddy Holly, and he'd hum along as we worked on the edges of the pie together. Those days in the kitchen, were some of my favorites. And lastly, when Hannah and I were born, he and Grandma bought the cottage, like mentioned before. The cottage was always somewhere that seemed so magical. This was where we learned how to fish. The lake was where we got the most airtime on the tube. His boat was always a nice spot to lounge and read. The food always tasted different there, and the magic of the place where the sunsets painted the sky and the stars shone overhead. He found peace there. He was always happy there, and the joy he got sitting on the deck, watching the water, and listening to the loons brought him immeasurable tranquility in his later years. It was the family safe haven, and he and Grandma gave that to us. And for that, we'll always be grateful. He was the one we always laughed with. He lit up the room with his smile, and he was welcoming and never hesitated to help. He teased relentlessly, but was always gentle, and he was sure. And he was the one whom kids gravitated to. He made sure we'd each get a helping of the little green aliens, pickles, at dinner. And he was the best papa, and I will forever miss being able to make those apple pies and laughing to nonsense while humming Frank Sinatra.
Thank you for being part of Dad's memorial today, both in person and online. With my father, you cannot separate the man from his ministry. So when I think of my dad, he was not only my parent, but he was my Sunday school teacher, my minister, my youth group leader, my Bible study leader. He was always the one at the front of the room. And if you ever did anything with Dad, it was an adventure. And what happens on an adventure? You take some risks, you face some fears, there's often a little collateral damage along the way, and sometimes there's even bad weather. Most certainly, there's beautiful views, and definitely, you experienced growth. If you got around Dad, whether in ministry, in the secular workplace, even in our home, that was what happened. You experienced growth. Mom has often commented over the years how her life would have been a quiet one had it not been for Dad, and that it has been quite an adventure. Dad had an open heart that expressed itself in our open home. A while ago, Stephen and I were trying to remember all the people that had stayed with us when we were growing up, and we soon realized that we needed to figure out categories of people before we could start a head count. There were refugee families and individuals, missionaries, covenant players, acting troops, Up With People performers, exchange students, college student renters, as well as teens, friends, and even strangers in crisis. The Fourney Hotel, as we were called, molded my outlook on God's call for us to be inclusive and to live a life of service. Dad loved small town people and city people, as he had been both. He did not judge where you came from. He just cared about where you were and where you were headed. He was a gatherer of people and ideas. He was a forward thinker. It did not take long to see the wheels were turning in his head with, what can we do next? He was always starting something new in the hopes of bringing people together. He created ways for people in the church to build and deepen relationships with each other and with God. And he was persuasive. You had to look out if he had an idea for you. He was very interested in the spiritual development of others. He didn't just want to talk about it. He wanted people to learn how to actually apply it in their daily lives and to live it out together. My father was a sentimental man, passionate. He felt things deeply, and he was enthusiastic. Whether he was leading youth group around a campfire, a Bible study around a living room, or a Sunday church service in a sanctuary. Dad always had projects on the go. Every house and every room got redecorated by Dad, and we moved a lot. I have many memories of Dad wallpapering, painting, and always featuring a room in dusty rows. Sharing life with Dad, I saw him build a lot. With his enthusiasm, he built community. With his encouragement, he built up people. With his ingenuity, he built up church programs. With his hands, he even built a bathroom here at St. Giles. And he turned a boathouse into a bunkie at the cottage. He thoroughly enjoyed working on the cottage, deeply motivated by the fun to be had when the kids and grandkids would come to visit. And he loved being by the water. The love he showed his grandchildren was often expressed through quality time together baking, as previously mentioned. And as a side note, in memory of Dad, the grandkids have been busy baking, so you'll find that in the church hall later. Dad enjoyed meaningful conversations with his grandchildren at any age, and he loved to wear a conversational starter. He had pink pajamas, he had a pirate costume, he had a Russian hat. Anything he did was never by half measures. When he wrote and published a pirate adventure series, he immediately bought the costume. He got into character for library and school presentations, and even to host an outdoor scavenger hunt for Hannah's birthday party. Often Dad was just a big kid. He had the insight to know when the best thing to do was just to be silly. He loved to have a good time socializing and being surrounded by people of all ages. This came out in many different ways, like sporting a kilt for Robbie Burns' night out, or staying up late into the night playing card games with friends. We went on many camping trips and vacations as a family with friends over the years, and as a child, I knew the road trip had officially started once Dad said, "We're off like a herd of turtles." Dad's relational personality and God-given skill set has enabled people all over our city, our province, people all over our country, and far beyond its borders to be impacted by his life and ministry. I loved that Dad saw in me what I did not, encouraging me to take on roles in the church and in the world that I thought I was unqualified for. These were the positions that I ended up loving the most. Dad was the one who could coax you out of your comfort zone, coach you from the sidelines, and watch you grow. In Dad's last months and weeks, he talked a lot about life and death with me and about faith. He reminisced about a freedom he first experienced as a teenager, having learned that a relationship with God was not actually about the rules and regulations, but about his creator's love and total acceptance of him. We talked about finding peace. He told me, "I know the Lord's waiting for me." And he told me that he was at peace. His concern was for his daughter, for his family, and for his friends to also be at peace as well. You cannot separate the man from his ministry. In Dad's early 30s, he was minister of Summerside Presbyterian Church and led the youth bicycle camp across the island. A fellow youth worker, Emily, would lead the young people in singing around the campfire in the evenings, and even campers from other campsites would come over and join in. One evening, she sang Bob Dylan's song, "Forever Young." Dad was very inspired by this song, and he decided he would like to have it at his funeral and memorial. He never forgot this idea, so we have a tape recording of Emily singing "Forever Young" at a campfire in PEI over 40 years ago. This song not only expresses my dad's youthful spirit, but reminds us of his work in youth ministry and his love for his grandchildren, "Forever Young."
May God bless you, keep you always. May your shadows all come with me. May you always be forever yours, and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on and grow, and may you spread. Thank you. ask for soul, and may you stay.
For our first scripture reading, comes from 2 Timothy 6 to 8. As for me, I am already being poured out as a libation, and the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight, I have finished the race, I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on that day, and not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing.
Our second scripture reading is Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations.
My grandfather preached his first sermon when he was only 16 years old. His text was Revelations chapter 3, verses 20 to 22. And last year, I got to listen to a tape of my grandfather preaching this sermon, recorded 60 years ago. The verses describe Jesus as the one who stands knocking at the door of our hearts and waiting to come in. Revelations chapter 3, verses 20 to 22. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and dine with him, and he with me. To him who overcomes, I will grant to sit with me on my throne, as I also overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit say to the churches. These verses remind me of how Papa approached his ministry. It was always about your own journey. Jesus was the one knocking at your door, and Papa was there to help you listen out for it.
Thank you for all your sharing and reading of the scripture. And before I begin, I'd just like to invite you to join me in a prayer. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Life is like running a marathon. How one finishes a race is as important as how one starts it or runs it. This marathon is not on the level ground. There are unexpected twists and turns, and sometimes one faces the so-called heartbreak hill. Heartbreak Hill is a legendary obstacle that challenges runners in the Boston Marathon. Starting at mile 13 of the race course, There are a number of hills and climaxing in mile 19 at the Heartbreak Hill. It is the longest, the steepest hill in the race. And what makes this hill even worse is that world-class runners usually hit the wall around mile 18 or 19, right at the Heartbreak Hill. Their bodies would have depleted glycogen stored in their muscles. That glycogen is in fact replaced with lactic acid that causes muscles to ache, to burn, to scream. And when you hit that wall, you just feel like you're going to die. And Heartbreak Hill tests runners to the very core of their determination and their strength. It is with that in mind that I turn my reflection to Reverend Dr. Robert Patrick Fourney, or simply Bob, as those at St. Giles have come to know him very fondly. Bob was a minister of the gospel, a man of God, who had answered the call to ministry early in life. He gave his life serving the church, and in this case, the Presbyterian Church in Canada. He held a number of pulpits, with the last three, perhaps more significant ones, of Summerside Presbyterian Church in PEI from 1976 to 1981, and St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church in Windsor from 1982 to 1996, and at Glenview Presbyterian Church in Toronto from 1997 to 2006. Throughout his long and productive tenure in congregational ministries, in presbyteries, in camping ministries, and in the national church, Bob had always had a special concern for young people. On top of raising their two children, Stephen and Ruth Ann, Bob and Jen had opened their homes to house at-risk youth, and not just at-risk youth, people from all walks of life who are in need, to provide shelter and a loving and caring environment to those young people with no one nowhere else to turn to. Scanning the acts and proceedings of the General Assembly of the Presbyterian Church in Canada, we find Bob leaving his distinctive mark on the work of the National Church. As early as 1985, Bob, at the time as a commissioner to the 111th General Assembly, tried to move a motion which was ruled out of order by the moderator then, based on a procedural ground. Undeterred, he came back with a proper and necessary notice of motion during that sederan of the same motion, which essentially asked that young adult observers be granted permission to speak on all issues brought before the 111th General Assembly, thus waiving the necessity for separate motion every time they may wish to speak. It's a simple no-brainer thing. And I might add, the motion passed promptly and has now become a standard operating procedure at all subsequent gatherings of the General Assembly. It was Bob's way of making sure that young adult representatives are able to participate fully in the debate of the highest court of our denomination. His concern for young people of the church brought him in 1986 to 87 to a key role as a convener of a special committee on youth and young adult ministries, which was instrumental in the formation of what we would have known eventually as the Synod Youth Director SYD program, which enables synods across Canada to employ youth workers to strengthen youth ministries at local congregations. I might add, SYD program or its equivalent continue to impact our denomination to this day. Bob was trusted by the national church. He was called upon to do important works. And we see that in one example, as he was thanked by the ministry and church vocation in 1995. For his contribution as a member of a task force, looking into developing better policies and procedures for dealing with sexual abuse and harassment, and to guide the church in handling such allegations with the aim of seeking restoration. Bob was well-liked and well-respected as a minister. Three times he was nominated for the role of the moderator of the General Assembly. The first time in 1993 by the Presbytery of Chatham. The second time, 10 years later, in 2003, by three separate presbyteries, Essex, Kent, Winnipeg, and Edmonton, Lakeland. The third time in 2005, and this time by four different presbyteries of Cape Breton, East Toronto, Waterloo, Wellington, and Essex, Kent, again. And one could see that his popularity was not diminishing, but rather growing over time. On top of his busy congregational ministries, somehow Bob found a way to complete and obtain an advanced degree in Doctor of Ministry from the Ashland Seminary. With knowledge and skills that enable him to serve that rather sizable congregation of Glenview in Toronto. I don't know where Bob found time to complete that degree. I tried to do a deeming degree once through the Toronto School of Theology while working full-time in my previous congregation in Montreal, and I couldn't handle the pressure, and I hit the wall. In a very different way, Bob also hit a wall. He faced his heartbreak hill in 2005 and 2006. Allegations of misconduct rocked his life and his ministry. Even though the complainant ultimately withdrew the allegations on the eve, no less, of the proceedings at a criminal trial, the disciplinary process of the church court at the East Toronto Presbytery continued on. It eventually led to the most unfortunate outcome of the end of his ordained ministry in 2006. Bob had always maintained his innocence and his integrity. Backed by his family and those who knew him, those who were closest to him. His biggest regret, from what he conveyed to me later, was that he never got his day in court to truly clear his name once and for all. The disciplinary process of the church court, which is supposed to bring about reconciliation and restoration, never came to pass. However, like a true marathon runner, Bob pressed on in faith. Bob and Jen and their families became part of St. Giles, an integral part, I might add, for a good portion of the past two decades. He reinvented himself by taking on different projects and different roles, developing various skills to serve the congregation, and in baking delicious apple pies and others, in renovating and constructing washrooms, singing in choir. He even wrote and published a series of adventure books for children and early teens. His faithful and sometimes humorous outlook in life was a blessing to many in the congregation, and many of you probably have your own favorite story to tell about how Bob had impacted your life. When St. Giles got into a bit of trouble in 2011, Bob brought his extensive ministry experience to bear. He contributed to the re-envisioning of St. Giles, laying the foundation of a rebuilding process, and co-convened the search committee with the late Reverend Dr. Cedric Pettigrew, which eventually brought me to St. Giles. For my part, I have to say that Bob and Jen were always, always the biggest encourager to Daisy and I. And ever since our arrival here 2 years ago, and offering timely and constructive advice, but always in wise and respectful way. When his health was deteriorating, and death loomed, I had visited him a number of times, either at the hospital or at his home. On my last visit, knowing that he may not have sufficient breath to convey all his thoughts, Bob wrote me this email beforehand, which I'm sharing with you today, and know that I do not do so lightly, but I truly believe the content of this email is a good testimonial of Bob's character and his faith in God. He began, "Hi, Paul. I had hoped to have some time with you alone during your visit today. Jan and Ruth Ann will be there for your visit. My problem is that I don't have enough breath to carry on any kind of conversation. Therefore, I thought it would be easier for me to convey my thoughts in this private email. Jen and I so appreciate you and Daisy, as well as the boys. I realize that you have been under a lot of stress, not only with the responsibilities at St. Giles, but also your family. Be assured, we hold you in our prayers. God is working through you, and you have been such a blessing to our congregation. I would like to share some arrangements," and here Bob went on to describe his funeral service, the one he hopes to have at Lancaster, and the memorial service that he hopes to have at St. Giles. And he continues, "As I am going through this time in my life, as the end is near, there's a quiet acceptance of death. In some ways, it is a sacred time of awareness as I can look back on my whole life. What is remarkable is to realize the presence of God throughout the whole of my life. When one is in the thick of living, this is not so obvious. But God has given me this special time to look at the whole expanse of my life, counting my blessings and dealing with regrets. There is also a time where Christ's death on the cross and his resurrection comes much more real. As we reach the end of life's journey, our hope in the grace and mercy of God and his promise of salvation is so very real. My one concern is with the family. Jan is a very strong person, but she will need your support as well as members at St. Giles. But the one I have a deep concern is Ruth Ann. She too is very strong, but my death will be hard on her. She and I have been very close. I would appreciate if you and Daisy would be her support. Can I share one concern? I noticed that you have a cough which comes out when you are preaching and teaching. I bring this up not to be personal, but out of concern. I wonder if you had it checked. Blessings, dear brother in Christ, Bob. I don't know how to say this. His faith is so solid, so real. His concern for others around him so genuine that while Bob was struggling for his last breath, he was concerned about my cough. I'm speechless and in awe. So Bob, I will say this in conclusion, borrowing the quote from the Apostle Paul in 2 Timothy chapter 4 of his own description of the life of faith he lived. Like a true marathon runner, Bob, you have fought the good fight. You have finished the race, and you have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for you the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give you on the glorious day of the Lord. So goodbye, my dear brother in Christ. Goodbye. See you later in heaven, if the Lord is willing. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us sing hymn 374, Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. We'll sing this to the tune of Asmong, which is hymn 730.
Oh, for a thousand
Let us pray. Holy God, by your creative power, you gave us the gift of life, and in your redeeming love, you have given us new life in Christ. We give you thanks for the life of Robert Patrick Fourney, for how he faithfully served your church, the body of Christ, and for how his life has touched ours. So therefore, into your hands, O merciful God, we commend your servant Bob. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. And we'll sing in closing hymn 611, For All the Saints. And we'll sing verse 1, 2, 4, and 8. In peace, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you from this day and forevermore.